Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Daniel Mulder for his talk, Can Hidden Data Patterns Predict Illness in Children?
So I believe hidden patterns are everywhere. Recently, I was practicing medicine, as we often do these days, by sitting at my computer. And a patient's blood work came into my inbox. The patient is Ada. She's a 7-year-old girl who loves figure skating. And she sees me because she has inflammatory bowel disease. I always look forward to seeing Ada because when she comes to the office, she giggles away while we talk about poop. What is inflammatory bowel disease? This is a condition where the immune system relentlessly attacks the gut. It causes severe belly pain, bloody diarrhea, and major challenges with growth. We treat it with powerful immune-suppressing medicines. With all this going on, patients need frequent blood work checks. Thankfully, Ada had been feeling well for quite some time, and her blood work had been rock steady, almost identical check to check. But today's blood work was different. It wasn't abnormal, as per the normal ranges on the report, but it was different than the previous checks. Some values were higher, but not too high. Some values were lower, but not too low. It was just different. I didn't make much of this, and I filed away the blood work. But then a few days later, Ada's dad called. She was having severe belly pain, bloody diarrhea, and she was too sick to go to figure skating. She was having a flare of her disease. And I wondered, was there a signal there in her blood work that could have warned us she was gonna get sick? Was there a hiding pattern there? My name's Dan Mulder. I'm a pediatrician scientist at Queen's University. But in truth, I see myself as a professional puzzle solver tasked with finding patterns hidden in health data so we can better help our littlest patients. So back to Ada. And just so you know, I've changed some of the details of my patients today for confidentiality's sake. I looked through research studies and guidelines to see if there was anything known about changes within the normal range of blood work that could have warned us about patients getting sick. But there was nothing. Was there a hidden pattern here that we previously didn't know about? So it's important now to understand blood work a little bit, why we do it, and what is normal and abnormal blood work. Being a pediatrician is an awesome job. It's very rewarding, but it has its challenges. One of those challenges is that children are not the most reliable storytellers. Whether they're trying to explain their symptoms to their doctor, or whether they're trying to explain where the cookies in the cookie jar went. So pediatricians often have to supplement our assessments with blood work. In a patient like Ada, when we do blood work monitoring inflammatory bowel disease, we get about 30 numbers back. Each one has a normal range associated with it. We don't expect one number for each test. It's a range, just like height. Patients often want to know when we do blood work, is my blood work normal? And we have these normal ranges. But the answer, like a lot of things in medicine, is it's just not that simple. So how do we decide on these normal ranges? Well, a large study is done in healthy people where the blood test is done. And we get a bunch of numbers back, a range. But the range isn't what we call the normal range. We actually define that as 96% of the range in the large study in healthy people. We do this because we know there's overlap between healthy people who are outliers and sick people outside of the range. We also know that if we put the range too narrow, we start to call healthy people sick. So it's not so much of science, is it? It's a bit more of an art. And what's normal and abnormal is not exact. So maybe there's signal hiding there in the normal numbers that could better help our patients. Finding these patterns in patients with inflammatory bowel disease blood work is the focus of my research program. Statistically, when we do blood work, if we were to do those 30 tests we did in Ada in 5 healthy people, statistically this means that 4 of those 5 reports would have abnormal numbers in them in healthy people. 80% of the reports would have abnormal numbers. So it's possible that the converse is true, right? That within normal numbers, there might be sick patients hiding. There might be signals there that there's disease. Learning how to interpret blood work in medical school was very rewarding for me. I found it fascinating that you could learn to see what abnormal results to focus on and worry about and what ones to put aside. It's a bit like learning to hear a musician on a busy street corner. You have to hear the melody amidst the sea of noise. But how do we learn to hear these melodies? And better yet, how do we hear the missed note that signals disease? So maybe I got a bit lucky with Ada. Her blood work had been so similar, and then it changed, and then she got sick. Is this happening in other people? In order to find these patterns, we collected blood work data from hundreds of patients with inflammatory bowel disease, thousands of sets of blood work, millions of data points, and we built a database with all these numbers in them. Then we sat down and we thought, how do we find the patterns in all these numbers? Nobel laureate Albert Senkurji said it well, in that research is to see what everyone else has seen and think what nobody else has thought. But it turns out that human minds are not good at finding patterns in massive spreadsheets full of data. Our brains are wired for survival. Humans are good at rapidly processing visual input, and we're good at making decisions based on limited information. Humans shine when we see movement in the corner of our vision. We have to decide, is it a predator, and act accordingly. But this is not how we're going to find patterns hidden in health data. But you know what is good at finding patterns in big data sets? Computers. So modern computing platforms can ingest massive amounts of data and find patterns the human eye might otherwise never see. This type of automated pattern recognition is called machine learning. It's a form of artificial intelligence. In machine learning, the computer tries an equation to see if it fits the data. And then it automatically tries another equation and another equation. It tries many, many, many equations to find the best one that fits the data. The key here is that the computer's not picky. It just does what you tell it to do. So you can imagine how frustrating it was for us when we analyzed our data using machine learning to see if the computer could predict if a patient was going to have a flare of their inflammatory bowel disease or not from their blood work. But unfortunately, the computer could only tell us just as good as chance, 50-50 shot, whether or not the patient was going to be sick or not. So then we had to think, how are we going to find these patterns we think might be there? We had to add back in the human element and think differently about the data. And we believe there's hidden patterns everywhere, and computers can help us uncover them. But we have to use the power of the human mind to help the computer work better. So let me give you an example of how we did this. When we first built our database, we started with the blood work, and then we looked back at the patient's record to see, were they in a flare at that time, or were they well? We looked at the subtype of disease they had, their age, what medicines they were on, all these things. We turned them into numbers, and we did the machine learning analysis on this. But then we remembered Ada, and that her blood work had changed before she got sick. So we thought, what if we back up the timeline? Instead of labeling people as sick, whether or not they have symptoms or not, what if we count them as a flare in some time before they show up with symptoms? We tried different timelines, and we found that up to 3 months before a patient starts to feel sick, their blood work does change. The patterns sang out from the noise. But what are these patterns? Well, they're mathematically complex. And thankfully for you and me and Ada, I did not have to sit Ada down and say, you know, your neutrophils minus the cube root of your monocytes is looking a whole lot better now. This is what's going on. Even that is a bit of a simplification. Instead, I treated Ada with rescue medication. She dealt with some side effects. And then she got feeling back to the baseline, and she was all the way better. But while this was going on, her blood work changed. And there were patterns there that the computer could see. We would never have seen these patterns in her blood work, no matter how many blood work reports we looked at one at a time. The computer can find these rapidly, easily, when we know what to look for. We're excited to start to translate these findings into the clinic, and we're building a platform right now that can help the computer analyze patients' blood work in real time. And maybe one day, if we're sure a patient's going to get sick based on their blood work, we could treat them and prevent a flare. patterns shape the world around us in ways that are challenging to see. But we can combine the power of computers with the ingenuity of the human mind to help uncover these patterns. It's like hearing a melody in a sea of noise. Thanks for listening.